Ghost. The Lord bless you for praying. You can have your seat. God bless you. Someone is saying that, what kind of church is this? That they are praying. Since I can be praying, they are still praying. We'll pray. Destiny happens to those who pray. Hallelujah. Bible says that since the time of John the Baptist, the heavens suffered violence, but the violence takes things by force. Hallelujah. Life does not give you what you deserve. Life gives you what you fight for. Apostle Paul said, I fought the good fight of faith. So in life, don't wait for that job. You must fight for it. Don't wait for the prophesy. This is the amazing thing in our generation, that we are happy concerning prophecy, but we are not happy concerning prayer. Because the way to pull prophecy into manifestation is prayer. So when I say, that's here the Lord, it means prayer topic. It will not happen just like that. So if I see a traveling door, ambassador, you must pray. You must pray. And that is my encouragement to us all. Pray. Pray. Life is not all about you. Life is full of all manner of demonic activities. I always say this in our dumb prayers, that in the book of Matthew chapter 10, also from verses 1, the Lord told the disciples, when you are sending them, that as I send you forth, can you go there for me, please? Matthew 10, verses 1. And when he had called unto him his 12 disciples, he gave them power against unclean spirit. I always say, I ask the Holy Ghost, I say, God, why would you give the disciples first of all power against unclean spirit? And the Lord said to me that the reason why my church is not realizing all I've said concerning their lives is because of these things called unclean spirit. They have a way of manipulating what God has said. They have a way of delaying destinies. They have a way of making people struggle they don't have to struggle for. Look at what the lady shared. Look at the testimony. And this unclean spirit. A glorious destiny can be aborted because of unclean spirit. So he said he gave them power against. He shows that we are in battle. He didn't send them to go and laugh. He said, the first power I gave you is battle. He gave them power against unclean spirit. You watch through family lineages and like nobody achieves certain height in families. Why is it that we are working, we are struggling, we are serving God? Someone asked me a question yesterday, said, man of God, why is it that, Charlie, those who are not serving God, it looks as if the things are working? I said, listen, when you give your life to Christ, you enter into battle zone. So for us, the things are working, it's already been finished. But we need to contend for it. Because it's so glorious that the devil doesn't want it to happen. Imagine you're a business person who wants a company or something, and someone enters into your office and you see that demon and you say, demon, come out of that devil. That's what the devil is looking for. But the one who doesn't have God is doing it is not, is inconsequential to the calendar of God. So the person can prosper easily, but because of what you carry, so the devil fights against us. So the devil is even fighting against church. Because the beauty of church is not just to come to church, but for you to become, to know who you are in Christ, your identity. The greatest revelation this Christian journey is, who are you in Christ? That is what matters. Who are you? Who you are in Christ is what matters. I've been sharing over and over again from beginning of this month and even last week concerning how that it is all about the grace of God. Who are you in Christ? You must know it. It must sink in your heart. You are the righteousness of God. God loves you. Have this assurance. God loves me. But look how the devil is fighting the average person. You see an average person who has been in church for 10 years, say, God doesn't love me. And you wonder. They don't know who they are. They don't know God's love. They don't know God's good over their lives. And that is the problem. Beloved, there's this treasure in earthen vessels. that the excellence of the power may be of God. God has deposited something in the church. Listen, what is sustaining the world is the church. If the church fails, then the world will fail. If the church fails, the world will fail. That is why we are important in what God wants to do in this end time. I want to encourage you, don't take your walk with God for granted. There is power in our walk. I said last week that God is interested in a walk with him that just come to church. A walk with him, you wake up in the morning and your quiet time. Holy Spirit, what are you saying? You wake up in the morning, you are speaking in tongues. You are speaking to your maker. And anytime you speak to your maker, he makes your day right. He makes your destiny right. But because many are not engaging their maker, they are not being made. The secret to purpose and you being made is in tied to your maker. Make time for him. Make time for him. And that is what the devil is fighting. The devil is fighting after our time with him. Because he knows that the secret to carry divinity is in time with God. It's making time for God. You know, even in church. The devil is so kind that he has brought a lot of activities in church than we making time for him. So an average church goer can go to church from January till now and he's not prayed 2 hours before in a church service. Because the devil is gradually creeping to the church. We can dance, cripple, do everything. But the vital life of Christ is being missing. And that is prayer. Making time for God. Today, we've even cut a lot of sermon short. We preach 30 minutes, 20 minutes, next day upon. Then we can give announcement for 1 hour. My church, 1 hour announcement. Then Bible. And demons appear in your dream. It's not an announcement I'm going to read. What you need is that seeing the Lord. But what be times you don't have that seeing the Lord? What can he? What funny? And that is it. Bible said in Genesis that evening and morning was the first day. Evening and morning. But today, we have morning and evening as the first day. What am I just trying? I'm trying to tell you how the enemy has changed everything around just to fight against the pull of God. Because evenings are where demonic activities have their field day. So what the enemy will do is that he will make us use our energy throughout the day. So in the evening when you have to pray, Rakopos. What you do when you see that witch will appear in your dream? Say, me soon, I know you are somewhere. You better talk. Because the devil is so kind. He's, but we say, in whom the God of this world has blinded their eyes. 2 Corinthians 4, verse 4. There is a God responsible for this world and the systems. So he's changing everything to suit his own plan. So if the church doesn't go back to the word of God, we realize that the God of this world has blinded us for years and you don't even know your identity. You don't even know your identity. Beloved, the average believer is struggling for an identity crisis. So one who fits into society where we are accepted, we feel like I must just be there. And that is the church today. And beloved of God, you are not made just to fit in. You are made to become the very image of Christ. You are made to represent God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I'm just exalting you. We are going to look at a very important topic today. I think we've been dealing with what do you mean? Church growth, right? And I think last week I spoke on what do you mean? Ecclesia and what? And its growth. What did you learn from it last week? Then, what did you learn? What did you take home? The Ecclesia and its growth. I was off to amplify her mic for her.
Hello.
Yes.
Okay, so what I got was anytime we don't allow God to build us, we give the devil the opportunity to prevail in the church. So as part of people of the church, we have to allow God to have his way in us to build a church. Yes, thank you.
Hallelujah. So how does God build a church?
Okay, so he laid upon our hearts his burdens, instructions, yes, for us to carry out in the church. So he can instruct you to be a financial secretary or a soul winner, or I mean anything to make the church grow. It could be anything depending on what he wants to do at every point in time. Yes.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
So that's just by the way, God bless you. But I started from last week and I spoke about the ecclesia and its growth. And I said in the book of Matthew 16 that the first time ecclesia was mentioned was in Matthew. And I said that the word ecclesia means church. The church. And as you must understand that we have the individual church and the corporate church. When it means like this, we are a corporate church. But as an individual, he's the church. The word church means they're called out. Those who have been called out. But today, we don't even have a church. 90% of churches are chapels. It's not church. Because the word ecclesia means called out. And the called out means that, you know, you are called out of your own mindset. You are called out of the world to take upon the mind of Christ. But today, those who are called out are still entangled with the world. So you're bad, sorry now, so for still this class, son and I ever said, yeah, we are not actually called out. We don't have the mind of God today in our services. It's very difficult to hear that, see the Lord in our meetings. It's very difficult. Because before the person will come to church, from Monday to Friday, has been work. Work has worked Jesus out of the person. So the person is not rebooting the engine. Or worshiping craft, no booting engine, no. Don't get high. But the life of the believer is to hear from God 24/7. My sheep heareth my voice. The life of the believer is to walk with God. Enoch walked with the Lord and he was not. But we are not called out here to even have a walk with God. Once the believer gets a job, that is it. I'm done with Christianity. Sunday, I'm tired. Man of God, my bro. And we are still not called out. So God cannot have his way through us as he ought to. That is why I'm very particular teaching about the ecclesia and its growth. God wants us to grow. That beyond your job, beyond the cares of life, make time for him. The secrets about destiny is found in God. Bible says you are dead and your life is hid in Christ Jesus. The beauty of your life is hid in Christ Jesus. Colossians chapter 3. Say, you are dead. So in the mind of God, you are supposed to be dead to all the activities of this world. But today, the world has taken supremacy over our being that we cannot hear the echoes of life anymore. Today, we can hear lust more than even the leadings of the Holy Ghost. We are moved with the world more than even the Holy Ghost. Our thoughts are filled with what the world is saying more than what the Word of God is saying. And how can that be the church? So that is why God designed the church and designed even us as leaders to pump into the people of God the Word of God so they can grow. A believer goes through few guilt or does a sin, then that is it. That's the end of their Christian walk. When scripture says that there's now no therefore condemnation against them which are in Christ, why are you condemning yourself? Why are you beating yourself so much? You did a mistake, get up, walk again with God. Bible says in the book of Jeremiah 31, verse 3. Said, I have loved thee with an everlasting love. Said, the Lord has spoken unto us of old, saying, I have loved thee. Can we understand this? Said, I have loved thee. And that love is an everlasting one. It's an everlasting one. So why do you think that God will change his mind concerning you because you did a mistake? Why do you think so? Why do you think that because you didn't read your quiet time in the morning, you are the worst of all sinners? Why do you think that because the Holy Ghost woke you up at 3, your eyes opened all right? I slept again. And woke up the whole day. 6 a.m. is there. You could have prayed at 6 a.m. And you are just feeling bad. Because you don't know how much He has loved you. Listen, I'm training in this way because the Christian journey is a long journey. So if you don't have certain understanding, you give up. You give up. You give up. If you don't understand what God has loved us for, you give up. Because the thoughts, the bombardment of your mind. And I don't even deserve it anymore. And sometimes, because of that, you want to do a lot of things to qualify God's love. But God's love, our qualification of God's love is tied to the qualification of Jesus. Once Jesus was qualified before God, this is my only begotten Son in whom I'm well pleased. That is all. That is our qualification. So your works doesn't matter. It's what He has done. I made it very clear. Ephesians 2 verse 8. Say, ye are saved by grace. You are saved by the grace of God. So if you are saved by grace, why would you do anything to get anything from God? Why do you think that it's by your evangelism that you get a thing from God? People even think that, why do you think that it's by your prayer that the job will happen? It's not by your prayer, it's by Jesus. He answers prayer. No matter how you do, rock, if He doesn't answer, you won't bow. You can't pray and answer yourself. He answers prayer. So the beauty of prayer is that you must be conscious of what Jesus has done for you. That's prayer. In the New Testament, so we don't pray to get things. We pray to lay hold of the finished works of Jesus. Because it's already done. So it's not saying pray. God, the marriage has been written down already. The job has been written down. So as you are, I'm speaking to us, I'm laying hold on it. That which is mine, I possess. That we say, that's why the Holy Ghost came. That He may show us the things that are freely given unto us. Because most Christians don't know what is given to them. They don't know healing is theirs. So you are saying, Himself took away. So as I'm speaking in tongues, if the same spirit that raised up Christ from the dead dwells in me, He shall vitalize my body. You are just charging your body. Life enter. And that is the beauty of this Christian work. But the church has never come to this point. We are still thinking that we must ask God for things, then anything will happen. Alright, the Bible says in the book of Ephesians 1 verse 3, blessed be God who has blessed us with all. The thing He had done, the thing already. Your deliverance has been settled in Christ. So it's not now that He's going to deliver you. The thing has been settled. So as I'm speaking in tongues, I'm speaking my deliverance. I cannot stay here. You rebel against it. That's the essence of prayer. But the church, we are not growing. We are not growing. That's why we go about what we think when we pass bottle as an end up with too many sheep. Tell me, front and say, woman of God, but let me show you all say, Charlie, we show body or share body or say, this one, the age man, Weber. Age man, I said, body is missing a mimo. So, what is happening is that we are swaying the people of God gradually and they are having their faith in things rather than Jesus. Gradually, we are putting our faith in things rather than Jesus. That if I do this, it will happen. But it's not about what you are doing, it's about what Jesus did on the cross. It is finished. The blood was because of you. Everything He went through was because of you. Your marriage, the beauty of your destiny, it was tied to it. That is why the church ought to grow. The church ought to grow. Hebrews chapter 5 verse 13 verse 11 downwards say, when for the time you ought to be teachers, ye have need again that one should teach you the elementary principles of Christ. And say, are you there, sir? I want you to run with me. I don't want to quote scriptures and run away. The Lord says, I should take my time, teach them. It's like those days. There's a difference between preaching and teaching. One say preaching is born who they are from. But teaching, you can't cry now anyway. He said, for everyone, no, go to verse 11, say. Say, of whom we have many things to say and hard to be uttered, seeing ye are dull of hearing. They say, we have many things to say, but we are dull of hearing. Social media, this sickness can kill you. So now I say, be healed in the name of Jesus. God can heal you. We are dull of hearing. We are dull of hearing. As the symptoms, no boy. And as a man of God, many symptoms. But they just shall live by faith and your symptoms. But because we are dull of hearing, no, Charlie, our flesh is more important. Charlie, it's louder than the word of God. Our flesh is louder than the word of God. What you are going through is louder than the word of God. Bible says that the secret of Jesus was that he looked away and he looked unto Jesus. That's the secret of faith. In the school of faith, you don't look at your problem and still look at Jesus. You look away and look at Jesus. That's in the school of faith. And many are dull of hearing. They think they cannot succeed in life. They can't be prosperous in life. You are dull of hearing. You are seeing the wrong thing. See the word of God. Joshua, this book of law shall not depart out of your mouth, but thou shalt meditate therein day and night. Deuteronomy says you are the head and not the tail. How can you be the tail and be okay? You are dull of hearing. Just see, we have many things. See, you are dull of hearing. Continue for me, say. For when, for the time, you ought to be teachers. So most of you have to be teachers by now. Because the way you sat in church from kindergarten, what nursery school, what go? Hey, we should be about still boy. Teacher, we ain't even through here. So we need to pray. 90% of Christians cannot even win souls because some of them need Bible. No, when for the time you ought to be teachers, you tell somebody open Genesis, have no cool revelations, so that's who you should share. When for the time you ought to be teachers, you have to master of your craft. We are still begging you to know. Look at where we are begging a lot of Christians. 90%, they are saying a lot of, they say Ghana is a Christian country. But a Christian, you know why? 90% of this Christian country, you know, you need Bible, no? You need Bible, no? Our convictions are not strong. You can tell a Christian, and an LGBT, those subscribe, 90% are even Christians. We are supposed to hold on to our heritage well. We are losing it gradually. You hear an issue, an argument online, and they say tithe is safe, and the 90%, I will not pay the tithe again. We hear that they say churches, it shows that we are not grounded in our faith yet. We are not grounded in him. Well, for the time you ought to be teachers. Well, for the time you ought to, but they said you have to teach someone. Teach the children coming that Jesus is the way. Jesus is the truth. But we are, so we are doubting Jesus only way. Is Jesus the way? I sat in Uber once. I spoke to an Uber driver. He was a Christian. I ran out. He's not a Christian. He's a religious person. Religious person. How do you fall? I was like, I don't know. Yes, was he Muslim? Was he Muslim? You're correct. Was he Christopher? This one is saying, so which one do I stand for? Anything goes. I said, hey, you don't know your faith at all. The only subject we don't take seriously nowadays is Christ. We take mathematics serious. We take our engineering serious. When the 90%, imagine they give it to us, the first apparent down person to schools. So we learn everything of the world. And that's the contention right now. Most of you, because of where you've entered, I feel, now make crack your head thing. Because you know science. So God says you are healed. He say, according to biology, you are quoting, you are telling God, according to biology, when the enzyme, the thing is moving, no. God says you are healed. Christianity doesn't make sense, it makes faith. So we want to use our logical minds to relate with God. That is why we are struggling. Our beloved, the church needs to grow. Ephesians chapter 3, verses 19. Can you go there for me, sir? Ephesians 3, 19. And to know the love of Christ which passeth knowledge. You are saying that, listen, you have to know the love of Christ, it passes knowledge. His love possesses knowledge. It doesn't matter the background you are coming from. He says, I stretch out my hands and I call you. It is you I'm interested in. The thing passes knowledge. You look at what you did in the past and God says that you are a prophetess. See, anytime, listen, anytime you agree with God's word, there's something wrong with you. Because the word of God is not for you to agree with. It will beat your imagination every time. God loves me. God, you love me. God, you care for me. Even what I have done, you still care for me. That say, the love of Christ passes knowledge. Say, to know it, and this thing passes knowledge. That is why it's not about you, it's about Him. It passes knowledge. This is the foundation of Christianity. It's about Christ. It's about Christ. And to know the love of Christ, which passes knowledge. That ye might be filled with the fullness of God. The way to be filled with the fullness of God. Know that His love passes knowledge. I call you. I call you. I was reading a scripture. And the scripture in the book of John 11. Bible says Lazarus was dead. And Martha and Mary, when she said, the one whom thou lovest is dead. And Jesus Christ loved. He loved. Because those I love, they cannot die. He said, the one whom thou lovest is dead. He said, no, this is not unto death, but it's for the glory of God. For the believer, anything you are going to is for glory. It's not death. No. We can't be disadvantaged in life. Everything we are going through is working together for our good and our purpose. God is molding us. He's shaping us through the circumstance of life. But we must certainly, we must know it. We must know it. But a Christian breaks down when they see diverse temptations. They give up when we see things that are not going the way we ought for them to go. We give up. God wants us to know that His love passes knowledge. You can't fail in life. You can't fail in life. His blood is speaking better things, so you can't fail. And that is the growth of the church. You must be bold in life. The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. The world and they that dwell therein. He said to Joshua, wherever the sole of your feet shall tread upon, I've given unto you. If you step in that company, it is yours. It is the Lord's. That assurance, confident assurance, that Christ in me, the hope of glory. And this is where the church must get to. Christ in me, the hope of glory. Bible says in the book of Romans chapter 8, verses, I think 3, can you read it for me, sir?
Romans chapter 8, verses 3.
Yes, sir.
For what the law could not do.
For what the law could not do.
In that it was weak.
Through the flesh.
God sending his only son.
In the likeness of sinful flesh.
And for sin. Condemned sin in the flesh.
Do you understand the scripture? He said that God, the law could not help us because we couldn't fulfill it. But God sent his only son in the likeness of a sinful man, just like you and I. But he looked before sin and strangled sin in his body. He strangled sin. This is why they can say cancer is in your body, but you can strangle cancer by the life of God. Rumpeke super, you are strangling cancer out. That's why cancer doesn't want you to stay in God's word. You are strangling it. They say nobody succeed in your family. You look at your family. I strengthen you. That's what the scripture means. He set his son and said, listen, let my son become mortal men like them. And whatever mortal men are going through, let my son strangle it in the body. And that's what he sent the son. That's why he said, as he is, so are you. You can also strangle death. You can strangle poverty. You can change family lineages. You can change the story of your family by the reason of Christ. And this is the growth of the church. This is the growth of the church. The church must grow. When I read the scripture, this thing, I knew them years ago. So when I'm going through issues, they say, doctor says, I strangle it in my body. Rapakapas. Greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. Rumbeke deke subapakata. After so winning, I don't cry. I've won souls. You've won souls, so what? What matters is not the soul you won, but the knowledge of Christ Jesus. That is the difference. Your advantage in Christianity is not how much you work for Him, but how much you allow His work in you to prevail. That's the advantage in Christianity. Let His work, it is Christ that worketh in us both to will and to do of His own good pleasure. Then you can work out your own salvation. Let Him work within you. Allow Him work within you. Allow Him lead you. That is the work of Christ. Allow Him teach the word of God. Allow Him. You are reading through scriptures, then He opens you. Allow Him work in you. He's working patience. He's working love in you. It is Christ. It is God that worketh in us both to do and to will. If it doesn't work in you, you can never do for Him. And that is the thing. The reason why many people cannot even reach out, they cannot be active, they cannot win souls, is because they are not allowing God to work in them. It's love. If you can see how much God loves you, how much God loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, you can see it. Beloved, you don't mind leaving everything for Jesus. You don't mind winning souls. You don't mind preaching Jesus. Because Paul said that this is my purpose. I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. It's the power of God. I'm not ashamed. So what it means that the gospel had a lot of shame ascribed to it. But he said, I'm not ashamed of it. I'm not ashamed. Apostle Paul. This guy was a murderer. But the gospel doesn't, listen, when you come to Jesus, it's not about what you have done. It's about what Jesus has done. So he said, I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. Because the gospel of Christ qualifies you when you're not qualified. That is the gospel of Christ. That's the gospel of Christ. I'm not ashamed of the God, because it's the power of God. The gospel of Christ is His grace towards you and I. I have loved you with an it's grace. I'm not ashamed of the gospel. Said, so this is the message. It's too good to be true and news. That me, I'm a lesbian, I'm a gay, God says I love you. That's the gospel of Christ. Bible says in the book of John chapter 8 that they brought a certain woman to Jesus Christ who was caught in the act of our adultery. And when he came to Jesus, he said, I condemn thee not. He said, go and sin no more. I said, why did you say go and sin no more? I condemn. He said, I condemn. He was saying that because I can forgive them, but they can still condemn themselves. So he was addressing the condemnation problem. I don't hold it. This is the gospel. I don't hold it against you. Settle it in your heart. Don't go and sin no more. But today, most of us, we are forgiving, but yes, we are holding it against ourselves. I can't forgive myself. We are praying, crying, I want someone to fly back. Who said, oh God, you saw how you're sleeping in that guy's shoes. Oh God, you forgive me, but. And the man of God is calling, he said, yeah, prophet, he said, me? Amen. Amen, man, come home. Amen. He said, but somebody was saying, amen. Mike. Because you don't know the quality of His love for you. A murderer was a pioneer of the gospel. I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. It's the power of God unto salvation. It's power. It's power. You are sick and He says be healed. That's the power of God. I'm not ashamed. Paul was so much at rest with the gospel. The good news. He knew his identity. All that I'm doing is I want you to know that, listen, there's a place for you in God. There's a place of, he said, listen, my peace I give unto you, not as the peace of the world I leave unto you. He told them, my peace. The word peace means eren. He said, my wholeness, my completeness, my joy, I give unto you. Because the world can give you a certain kind of peace, but it cannot take away certain. You see, you realize that the sorrow is still there. You realize that there's no fulfillment. You are still depressed after getting the money. It's amazing about having money, but yesterday I depressed. There's only, listen, your heart was made for God. The only one that satisfies the heart is God, not money. The way your heart is looking for the job, you get a job. I see people who are looking for a job, they get a job, then 1 week, 3 weeks, as of which my major, you. At the same prayer meeting, God give me job. Now realize that life is beyond job. The heart longs for its maker, that is God.
its maker, the heart. Your heart was created for God.
That's why whenever you fall in love with your heart, you be also for say, my heart is broken.
Because listen, no man can meet your heart than God.
That was a walk in love, not fall in love. People are falling in love. Say, he has broken my heart. You marry all the nice things. You enter to marry and 1 year now. It just tells you that nothing endures. Nothing endures. You get the job, you go to job Monday, Friday, you're like, and you're just there in your heart. You Adi Minjai. Realize nothing endures. The heart is only made for God. So anytime you don't make time for God, you realize that's when the heart begins to find joy in other things. Let me just go to the nightclub. Let me just do something. That's why we are in a generation, we just want to do something. We are in a doing generation. Because if you don't do so, you feel like you are not fulfilling destiny. So you must do something. But Christianity is not about doing something. It's like embracing what he has done for you. That's Christianity. So if you are sitting, you are even praying, you are waiting on God, because the mind has been trained to do something. Oh, Rumi, wait on God. Hear from God. So you know, not funare again. The body wants to react. So in the place of prayer, you cannot even pray well. That's why when you enter into prayer, you realize that immediately you close your eyes, you want to pray, then you realize, someone says, touch your phone. Press your phone. So how about her phone? She needs to have her phone. You receive a call. Because the devil knows that destinies are in God's presence. That's why you must come back and train ourselves to love God more than any other thing else. And that is the education, that's the church. Bible says he gave some apostles, some prophet to equip the church, to train the church to come back. So that when you are walking and the voice of God comes, that's here, the Lord, you know this is God's voice. You don't say, is it my mind? A lot of Christians say, Bibi catch rem you, but my Bibi no. Then you ask Bibi, then Bibi no. It's the Holy Spirit of God. They don't even know that there's a Holy Spirit in this Christian journey. Bibi catch rem. Tell me bomb pipe. Then I say, Bibi. Then Bibi no. The Holy Spirit of God. I hear a dream. Say, Miss Sunday. I say, no, a dying can say, God is showing your future. But because you don't understand, what the hell? You are looking for peanuts because you don't understand. I know the plans I have for you, said the Lord. Plans of good and not of evil to give an expected end. Hallelujah. Beloved, I'm going to talk about the work of God and the work of ministry. In the book of John chapter 6, verses 29, but we can read from verse 28. I hope you are being blessed. But I'm just scratching the surface after I'm preaching. The work of God and the work of the ministry. Then said they unto him, what shall we do that might work the works of God? We might work the works of God. One of the key things that I think that has worried Christianity in Ghana is that because sometimes you want church growth by force, so we deem the work of God as do soul winning, do evangelism, courage. You see how he's holding the media. He said, that's the work of God. Can you do the work? He said, the thing is of God. So only him can do it. The work of God. Do I ask him? He said, how can we do the work of? And we say, of, it's coming from you. How can we do the work of God? And Jesus Christ said to them, the work of God is not to carry. And go and say, God loves you. He said, no, that's not the work of God. He said, the work of God, go to verse this, that explains it. No, just read it. He said, and they replied and said, what shall I do to do the work of God? Continue. Just do the King James, and I tell you TPT, just. Now this thing is, and Jesus answered and said unto them, the work of God. And Jesus answered and said unto them, that this is the work of God, that ye believe on him
whom he had sent. So is it clear to you? So what is the work of God? Believe in Jesus. That is the work of God. That is the work of God. Believe in Jesus. Say, how shall we do to work the work of God? Say, the work of God is believe in Jesus. Believe that the word of God is more real than whatever you are going through. That's the work of God. That's where God wants you to get to. Believe that God's word is more true. Whatever scientists have said, whatever your lecturers have said, this word is authentic. Believe in it. And that is the work of God. That is what God is doing this end time. The work of God. Believe that when the doctor said that you have this, the work of God. By his stripes are made whole. Believe in it. That's the work of God. That thing you cannot work it out is being finished by Christ Jesus. Said, this is how. He said, you must believe in it. You must believe in it. So before any activity we can do for God, this is the first assignment. You must believe in it. Because you can't be effective on the field when you don't believe in the work of God. Because along the journey, you feel depressed. Along the journey of serving Christians, your mother will pass away, your father will pass away. But can you believe that all things are working together for your good? That is the work of God. You find people who are serious for God because they didn't get a job, that I'm quitting God and not serve God again. It shows you that God's work has not had its full dealings in your heart. The work of God. Believe in it. Believe in it. I have loved you, believed in me. That is the work of God. He wants you to know that he loves you. That is the work of God. That's why God is fighting for you to understand that he loves you. He's calling you. He needs you. You are important. You are not a mistake. God has a plan for your life. That is the work of God. Bible says, and the word of the Lord came unto Jeremiah saying, before I formed thee, that is the work that I had in mind before I formed thee. And this is the work of God. But however, a lot of Christians have just remained in this place. So realize that it's only a selected few who know the work of God. That God loves them. I'm the righteousness of God. We are holy. We are priesthood. We are holy priesthood. A chosen generation called out to show forth the praise of him who has called out of darkness. It's only few who know these things. Who knows that God, they are the healed of God. It's only few. Bible says in the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 8 verses 1, that knowledge puffs up. So we have a lot of Christians who are arrogant. They are arrogant because they are full of knowledge. My beloved of God, after the work of God, there is the work of the church. And that is what I'm here to talk about. And God calls us to do the work of the church. That's the work of ministry. And what is the work of ministry? The work of ministry is to release the work of God to their generation, that it is finished. God took away your sins. That is the work of ministry. But the reason why the church has not been effective in doing this thing is because there's a barrier between our work, between we understand the work of God in our lives. We don't understand it. So we are not bold enough to proclaim the work of God to our generation. That is the problem. The young lady is not confident that God loves me, so she cannot even preach the gospel. The young lady, though she's a Christian, but she falls down 7 times a week. Because they don't understand the work of God. That you can stay pure no matter what. My body is the temple of God. No matter how I feel like sleeping with another guy, I can't do it. That's the work of God. That's the work of God. Be holy. You can be holy. You can be righteous. But they are not confident in it. They are not confident in it. So it's like their Christianity is like a roller coaster. I fall in addiction. I fall in sin. I fall in this. So God is waiting for you. When will my daughter wake up to proclaim my words to their generation? How would that family see the glory of God? Every time they are crying, God, why are you? And God is also asking them, why are you also? The work has already been done. but they are not embracing the work of God. They're not embracing the work of God. Beloved of God, God has called us. Beloved, listen. When the church stops sending men, the church ends and the church will begin to die. In the book of Mark chapter 3 verse 14, he called them to be with him that he may send them. He called them to understand his work. Then after they have understood, he can send them to proclaim, "It is finished." I entered one office the other day and there was one lady who was dead. I said, she was sick. I said, "Isn't there anyone who understands the work of God over here?" I said, can I pray for that lady? Because per scriptures, her health had been perfected in Christ Jesus. But because most people are not confident in it, they don't even know. So they're not effective for God. They're even scared that if I even lay hands, what will happen? The work of God has nothing to do with you. It has everything to do with Christ. That's why I'm confident working the miraculous. I can say, "Be healed," and you take it. I know it is working. I know. But the church has not grown in the knowledge of God's work. And that's what I'm talking about today. The reason why you are seated here is not to sit here till you grow and will bury in the church. Today, that's today's Christianity. They go to a church, they know they'll be buried over there. So whether they are preaching or not preaching, they will stay there. Because you are thrown in the calendar. Me who are you see me? Now, sir, so I may buy a year see you. One day see you. That's the secret. Today's church is more secret than growth. May I wear never my wedding? Now, funny dream, when I remember wedding, I was off from November wedding. You bet 2 bars, you bet smoke 2 bars. This is why many are in church. But the purpose of church is your spiritual growth, to understand the work of God so it can be effective for God. How can you be in church and you think, "If I die, where is immortality locked up in you? Where is immortality?" We cannot strangle death today as a church. We cannot strangle death. You see your daughter struggling academically. You cannot strangle academic failure. We cannot do it because we don't understand the work of God. Christ is made unto you wisdom. I can't fail in life. That is the work of God. I entered that exam hall with confidence. I'm not alone. Bible says that do not be covetous. But Bible says that be confident that as he is, so are you. Be confident. So let not your conversation deal with covetousness. But as it is written, "I'll be with you." So they may boldly say, "The Lord is with us." That's the confidence in life. That's the confidence in life. Beloved of God, one of my mentors in the Lord, she and the wife were driving a car, and the bridge was just a one-way bridge, and there was another car coming, going to collide. Said, "This is an accident." And the wife shouted, "Jesus, Jesus." Said, "One Jesus is enough to deliver us." Said, they closed their eyes, they held their hands. But then they realized they had crossed. They don't even know what happened. They had crossed the thing. That's the weapon. Be confident. That's the weapon. One Jesus is enough. One Jesus is enough. Beloved, if the church will be effective, you must understand the work of God. Because we won't sit here forever or suffer. God wants others to understand the knowledge of him. So the reason why he's called you here to hear from him, so you can also go out there. They take your mom to the hospital and they tell your mother, they give her days to die. "I change the days. It's appointed unto man to die once." It's an appointment. "I change the appointment dates. I change the appointment dates. Christ died, so I change the appointment dates. When I'm ready, you can go. But for now, you are staying." You can be an effective minister in your home because you understand the work of God. He called them to be with him that he might send them forth. Bible says in the book of Genesis chapter 3 verse 8, the Bible says that after man had fallen, because God knew that his works has already been complete, but he needs a vehicle to transport the works to humanity.
Bible says in Genesis 3 that, and they heard the voice of God walking in the garden. They heard the voice of God. When the voice of God is ceased, man struggles. And man goes through a cycle of condemnation, a cycle of sin, a cycle of demonic activities. So whenever God wants to deliver human beings, he sends a man. So what's it? And the voice of God worked. Though the work was completed, that he has loved them. But we say the Lamb of God was slain before the foundation of the earth. So the work was finished before the foundation of the earth too. But then, Bible says, and the voice of the Lord walked in the garden. And when he got to the garden, man had already sown fig leaves. Man had made his own apparel. Man wanted to beautify his life. Because when, you see, when sin comes into your life, you want to make everything possible to live. You want to make it right. But the rightness is not in your power. When sin comes into your life, you want to struggle. It's like, that's where hustling comes from. So you shall sweat and you shall eat. That's hustling. So today our generation are hustling. But the way out of hustling is in the voice of God walked. Because many are not willing to hear the gospel. Now listen, you can come out of hustling. But the Lord is my shepherd. I shall let him lead you. Let him lead you. The job you are doing, you see now who led you to it. The university you are going to, see now who led you to it. That's why man is struggling. Man is trying to make it on your own. That is why God always sends men as voices. So today, the reason why you can be free, you can be led, you can understand, because God has sent a man. And the voice of God walked. The cure to every condemnation is God's voice to his generation. But without any preacher, how can we hear the message? That's why it saddens God when you're not preaching the gospel. It saddens God. You know too much, you are sitting what you know. Today, today we have formed societies and communities in church, committees. So we can close church and we are happy with our own committee. We can laugh with one another. We can quote Hebrew, Greek, but somebody is dying out there. And we are not willing to walk. The church, we want to sit and we don't want to walk. But after sitting, it's walking. If my child, from the day I gave birth to her, she's been sitting, I'll be worried. Because at a certain stage, I expect her to walk. I expect her to make certain utterances. And today, God is worried at the church. Because some people have been sitting in church since God knows how long. They know the tedium. They know the, what's the name? I was a Methodist. They know the canticles. All the can what's not so or call university and they say something else has taken over. You go and invite, they don't even go to church again when they enter university. A bokon roof a fair baby. A bonus, young boy. Preach the gospel, not preach the gospel. And you are coming out after what school fees they are paying, they are coming with pass. Where is the glory of God on that campus? God sent you as an envoy upon the land. God sent you as an ambassador upon the land. But where is the impact you are making? So many are dying. Many are sinning because you're not rising up. If the voice of God didn't work in the garden, we would not have heard of any good news concerning Adam. In the beginning was the Word. The Word had everything. You are healed. The Word had the forgiveness of sins. But if the Word never worked, will not have seen. Bible says, God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten. If the Son was not sent, we will not be here today. We will not be here today. The word of God we are reading today, many shed their blood for it. Many died at the expense of just the word of God. Today, I can come out of sin. Today, I can come out of the doctor's report. The doctors told me, you have this infirmity. I came out by the word of God. I came out. So you have infection from, don't mention the codes of it. I come out. But the reason why I could read and appreciate and come out, because somebody bled.
Someone left Korea just to bring the word of God to my forefathers. Someone came and did a crusade and said, Jesus saves, Jesus heals, God loves you. Someone did it. They left their comfort zone. It was said that the early days church, they'll leave their country, they are carrying their coffins because they don't know whether they'll go back to their hometown. They don't know whether they'll go back. They don't know. Because it's a matter of life and death. And we're willing to die for the Lord. But the church today, we are not willing to die for Him. That's why we are not growing as a church. That's why the campuses are filled with immorality. Because the lady that was sent over there to be a prophetess of the land, she went there, she also joined them. No prayer life. She wakes up. Oh, you wake up 9 o'clock. First thing, breakfast. Then they'll call her from home. I draw mommy who? And she's just there. Oh. When everything that required for life was given to you. When power was placed within you, said, behold, I give thee power. I give you power. Go ye therefore. And we are sitting down. Comfortable Christians. We don't even seem to believe it again. Whether it is true or it's not true. And it's the struggle. God is calling you to go out there with the gospel. Would you preach the name of Jesus? Would you preach the name of Jesus? Because the only way that lady can know that, the only way that prostitute know that God is not against her is you speaking. God loves you. I remember one day around Accra Mall, I was walking and the Holy Ghost said to me, get back and tell that young guy, Jesus loves you. I turned and I said, Jesus loves you. The guy chased me. Why did you say that? I said, I don't know. But I had this impression in my heart that Jesus loves you. First, share her story. His story. Nobody has ever loved me. I came out from a broken home. Wept! Because a man said, Jesus loves you. But if I wasn't available for God to say, Jesus loves you. I met a young guy. I've shared this testimony. And the young guy came to my house. But in the space of 5 minutes, I said to that young guy, can I say a word of prayer for you? The young guy is a chef. Mom and dad has no money. I said, listen, I know a God that helps me. Irrespective of family background, I know a God. He takes one from the miry clay and establishes them upon rocks. Those who are not kings, he set them among princes. I know a God. I said, listen, I just want to lead you to that God. I prayed for this young guy. He spoke in tongues. And the Holy Ghost used my tongue and said, you go to school. I don't know how the school fees. I don't know. But as I'm talking to you, the guy is doing his degree, come to finish. I said, hey! God. God. You shall know the truth and the truth shall make you free. He was dependent on family. But I said, lift up your eyes. From whence cometh my help? I said, there's a help that is eternal. Lift up your eyes. You are looking so much at men. Lift up your eyes. Help is in God. Beloved of God, if I wasn't sent, what would have been the story of this young guy? The reason why God wants you to hear what you are hearing, because He wants to send you out there. 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 16. Read the Passion Translation for me, sir. Roko Boshi Panaya Satis. First Corinthians 9:16. Said, for ye see, even though I proclaim the good news, I can't take credit for it. For my labor. For I am compelled to fulfill my duty. Your duty is to preach the word of God. That's why you're on earth too. Your first duty on earth is to preach the word of God. Are you preaching the gospel? Are you preaching the gospel? I always tell people that the reason why God gave you the privilege to go to school, so at least you can be literate enough to preach the gospel. When you enter the bank hall, you can preach the gospel song. The reason why most of you, God wants you to attain certain PhDs, certain degrees. So when the doctor is talking, you can also talk as a doctor. Do not see as a failure. You can talk as a doctor. I'm introducing you to Jesus Christ. That's why God wants you to prosper. That's the essence of prosperity. So before the rich, you can proclaim that I am what I am by the grace of God. Jesus made me rich. Give your life to Him. That's why God wants you to go far. But people want to. That's why today people cannot go far, because they want to go far without purpose. They want to go far without purpose. You abuse the glory of God. You abuse it. You abuse it. Can a number of people who are sitting in offices and they are sleeping with young girls because they are bosses, and you are a Christian? Which church do you go to? Who was your father? Who taught you the word of God? It's an insult to the kingdom of God. Insult of you to raise prayer meetings. Nobody dies in this office. This company will succeed. Ghana will not go down because I'm here. We don't have such a voice. We don't have such a voice. Because we are okay. We are sitting down. We are okay. And we are even twisting the gospel. They are so cunning. I'm an elder. In the about 20 years, elder, you can say that. Don't you know your body is the temple of God? Don't you know the lady you are dealing with, she carries God? Would you mess up her destiny because of job? God wants to raise men who can represent Him well. So listen, I'm compelled to do this thing. For I'm compelled to fulfill my duty by completing this work. It would be agony to me if I did it not. Constantly preaching the gospel continue for me, sir. If it were my own idea, say it would be agony if I do this thing. No. It would be agony. I know the number of lives that have been saved because of preaching gospel. I know how lives have turned around because one young boy stood up to preach the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. I mean, it will be agony. It will be agony. Do you know the number boy in agony because of you? Do you know your friends who are in agony because of you? They are struggling with lust when power is in your hands to deliver lust. But you are there. You are mixing with them. You have become one with them. You have become one with them. Scripture says that do not be equally yoked with unbelievers. We have become one with them. We put Christians, we don't even know that you're Christians, you are Buddhist, you are Mala, we don't even know. We don't know. Because the way you carry yourself, we don't know. I don't preach on dressing that much, but I tell people that also, if you're a Christian, then we shall be a Holy Ghost better. I don't know the Holy Ghost we have. About me dressing as we turn here, no now. Huh? We are not called to preach on dressing. No. We are called to preach the Holy Ghost. When I preach the Holy Ghost, He begins to work in your heart. You just wear, how many of you have been there? You just wear a dress, realize He checks you, say, ah. You realize, nobody's judging you, but say, Adia who say M wanyame. But today we don't even hear that again. You see a young girl, so young girl, born as soon as a 5. So I go to church. Which church do you go to? Which church? Do you understand church? The word church means you are living what you think is right, what the society thinks is right to fulfill God's will. Is there a right before God? When you stand before God, can you pray to God and believe God that He will bring answer prayer to somebody without it? Can you do it? You don't even have confidence in it. Can we do it? We are failing as a church. Agony. Many are in agony because of us. Also, for my final year, 2 guys nearly died in front of me. Go to write exams. I said to them, I'm the salt of the earth. You don't die when I'm around you. Get up, go and write the exams. they wrote the exams. One guy has traveled, he's married now. Imagine I didn't preach the gospel. Agony. You are that voice now. God is sending, walk in the garden and go and tell man, God hasn't held it against you. You are that voice. Can you walk? And the voice walked in the garden. The church, we don't want to walk, we want to drive. When you car on your evangelism, when you coming back, sorry, I want Uber. We invited Sonu. Sonu, I will car. I said, I want Uber. When you cars, I didn't get cars. I don't come to say, when you embrace, it's too far. But you can go to, you can go and do surgery in UK. You're better fine. Take it, Ibeko. But Jesus, who can save you? You can't just pick and come. You don't know what will happen to you. You don't know what will happen to you just by hearing God's word. Bible says he sent forth his word and healed them. And delayed. So you don't need just let the word be sent. That is all. He doesn't even require your faith to just allow the word to be sent. So you are sick. Come to church. As you are hearing the word of God, it's being sent. It's healing you. Ah, you begin to feel the peace of God. You begin to feel a man hug you. You begin to hear, I'm in love with you. The Lord is speaking to you. You begin to know that knowing that there's this refreshment around you just by hearing God's word. He sent forth his word and healed them and delivered them from all their distresses. Man is going through a lot of distresses, but the antidote is the word of God. Who speak the word of God? That is the problem. Who preach the word of God? Who sent for the word of God? Your mother is waiting for you to speak the word of God. Mommy, you can't die. It's enough to bring her back to life. Mommy, the job will work. Mommy, the marriage will work. We prophesy. Nobody gets married in this home, but mommy, I stand as the oracle of God. I stand as the priest. I stand as a child of God. Mommy, we'll marry. We break that yoke. He sent forth his word. Who preached the word of God? Can God send you? Can God send you? Anytime you don't preach the word of God, sin abounds. Anytime you don't preach the word of God, sin abounds. What you are seeing on your campus because you didn't preach the word of God. Because somebody went to campus and the Lord told him, you have called you as a preacher, but you do not know. Why need you? See, the person decided to mix with the world. The person decided to live a common life, a normal life. So nobody took you serious. God so loved the world that he sent. Anytime God loves a generation, he will send a man. Can you preach my word? Can you do my work? But the church today, nobody wants to be sent. One will sit down. Come to church every day, sit down. 10 years you are in church. You don't have any soul attached to your name. Nobody has become a Christian because of you. Nobody is speaking in tongues because of you. But you are in church 10 years. What kind of church are you going to? He always calls you first of all to know him. Then he will send you. Can God send you? Can God depend on you? Do you know why he can speak good English? Because he wants to depend on your English. Because there are certain environments, if the person speaking tree cannot really be effective over there. So the reason he took you to the best of universities, he took you to the best of schools. So when he begins to speak, they wonder, they are startled. Say, ah, you are eloquent. You are intelligent. Then he tell them, Jesus loves you. He's the reason behind this. Then they are amazed. Wow. We've not found a godly person like you before. For the past 10 years, we've not found a godly person. 90% of the girls, when they come here, somebody will open their legs and sleep with them. 90% of the guys, when they come here, they are not reasonable. They are corrupt. One day, I remember I went to national service. I was a bit late or so. When I was done my national service, I wanted to my national service certificate. I got there. Young guy doing national service. Say, put some money down. I said, wow. So you are fighting the leaders, but you are not even there. You've started corruption at this age. Young boy, where is Jesus in you? Then I asked him, where do you go to church? Where do you go to church? Because the problem is, when you are going to church, you are not being matured. you dance, have a friend of God. Today's church, we are preaching on money, business. 10 ways to make it. There's no 10 ways to make it. He's the way, the truth, and the life. That's the message. Jesus is the message. It's not 10 ways to make it. 10 ways to get a job. I've never stood here and I've prayed 10 ways to make it. People are getting jobs. I've never stood here 10 ways to travel. People are traveling. Because when you preach Jesus, he makes good things happen to us. He's the secret behind breakthroughs. He's the breakthrough himself. Anytime Jesus is preached, people begin to experience breakthroughs in their lives. Those who are not married begin to get married. Those who have not traveled begin to travel. Because every good, every perfect comes from above. A man can receive nothing except it be given him from above. The thing can't happen except God visits a man. Can we open our ears to hear the voice of Jesus again? Can we make time for him? Can you preach his word? Young man, can you wake up? Awake, O Zion! Put on your strength. Your strength is the preach of the gospel. Put on your strength. Put it on. Can we wake up once again? Paul said, woe is me if I preach not the gospel. If it were of my own idea, as a way of making a living, to do also for people think that we are using to make a living on. Oh, how pity our generation is. See, if it was my own idea or way of making living, as of what? I would expect to be paid. Since it's not my idea, but God's own commission, but God who commissioned me, I am entrusted with the stewardship of the gospel, whether I'm paid or I'm not paid. I'm entrusted. I wake up sometimes, I don't feel like preaching, but I'm entrusted. I must do it. I have no excuse to give. I sit in the church, my heart begins to pant. I remember those when I sit in church, my heart begins to beat. I know I have to preach the gospel. I'm entrusted. Because there's one soul who needs to just hear me. One soul. One soul. One soul. And God is awakening me. He said, just talk to him. I sat in one church when I was doing my national service. One young guy, Rastafarian, he said, well, you don't even talk to them. But the Holy Ghost said, talk to him. I started. I didn't know how to start. That's why it's not about how you start. Just let him flow through you. People are scared. Fear is taken away. People are not even able to preach the God because they are afraid. I'm not giving the spirit of fear. Why are you afraid? That's from the devil. Once you experience fear, it's the devil. Because the devil wants to withhold you from doing it. Because the person needs that deliverance. So the devil block it by your fear. So I'm not, I don't even know how to do it. And the reason why we are not confident is because we don't know the finished works of him. We don't know it. So we think that because I didn't do my quiet time, I cannot preach today. That's a problem. Preach in and out of season. There are times it's not even in season, but you must preach it. That gospel is not, and it's not when I feel like, in and out of season means also when you are just the Holy Ghost, say preach. You may not have done your quiet time, say preach. That's it, in and out of season. And that is when the deliverance of many people are attached. I don't know. The deliverance of most people is not the day we organize, let's go for evangelism. It doesn't work. That thing is, it comes with little results. But the deliverance is when the Holy Ghost prompts you, do it. And you do it. Jesus loves you. The person will just be shaking. As also, the guy was shaking in the car. Rastafarian, he was shaking. He was crying. He wrote his number down. I didn't say write your number. He wrote his number down for me. Years ago, I remember I went for one meeting. I nearly went. And the prophet called me and said, there was a soul you met years ago. And you were supposed to follow up on him. I didn't follow up on the guy. It was awful. I preached, but I didn't follow up on him. Said, the guy is called, he said, his soul is crying for deliverance and it's attached to you. I said, mercy. I didn't even know that. I didn't even know what to do. God has a need, the church. But always we go to God with our need. God has a need. That guy would have been a door to me, also if you don't know. Just me saying Jesus to you, that guy would have become a top preacher in the US. And today I can go to the US and be preaching with him because I preach to this young guy. And because I will be little people. He told Peter, the first fish you find, there's gold, take it out. Behind every soul is gold, a door, an open door. The people have just preached to today, they are doors to me. I just preach to them. God loves you. There is nothing I need to not do for me because I gave them a solution. But we are looking for money elsewhere, forgetting that the real money is in the soul. A real prosperity is attached to men, not material, not paper. Paper can go away, but we have men around you. You can never go down. There are people who don't have money in their pocket, but every nation, they have men over there. Every nation, they have men. And the only way to have men is the gospel. Can you preach to someone Jesus loves you? You may not know the person today, but 10 years to come, the person can become better. And that person will give way to your children's children because you preach Jesus to that person. Why are we belittling the gospel? Why? God calls us. God calls us. It's your responsibility now. The work of God has been finished. Now the work of the ministry must be done. If anyone will come after me, let him carry his cross and follow me. John chapter 12, verse 24. Ora papa ba shabina makope sabinimika. Just speak in tongues. Leba batu sis. Rema namash. I see something happening in the realms of the spirit. Marogobo shama namasoba. I see someone, I see a strong healing anointing coming upon someone. Romo momo shima manaskobe lebesa. Remene meskope lebesubahaya. Lift your voice, speak in tongues.